The thing I like about the story is that while he's a scientist, he has to apply his scientific knowledge to extend his survival until a rescue mission can arrive. This is what engineering's all about.
I think dust is going to be a big problem in the exploration of Mars, as it was on the Moon. The winds on Mars can pick up lots of dust and put lots of dust particles in the air. Like at noon on Mars can be almost as dark as midnight. What they got wrong is that that does not happen like 4 to 6 times a year. It happens maybe a few times in a part of Mars, but once every 5 years or so, they cover the entire planet. We have the site in Owens Lake in California. That's a dry lake bed. That's the largest source of dust in the US. We have a network of sensors there operating continuously. So we use that place as a test bed for instrument that one day we want to send to Mars. If you're able to protect yourself, to be able to filter that dust, then this is not going to be a huge problem. So I think it's more a question of having the resource to survive, oxygen to breathe, food and water.
Mars is an extremely harsh environment, very cold temperatures. Because the atmosphere is so thin and there's no magnetic field on the whole planet, the surface is constantly bombarded by radiation from the sun. The lead character, Mark Watney, overcomes this by moving his farm indoors into his domed habitat, much like this greenhouse. It provides warmth, it provides light, and it provides shelter from the radiation, which they must have had in place in order to have the humans working there. The soil on Mars has the basic chemicals that a plant might need, but there's no life present in the surface soil. In the book, again, Mark Watney enriches the soil by using a combination of small amounts of earth soil that were brought along on the trip for experimental use and his own, shall we say, fertilizer. I think that would be the only way that he could possibly create this soil. At the University of Michigan Space Physics Research Lab, we're currently working on a new instrument that's going to be launched in 2018 on the European ExoMars rover. That is specifically designed to look for more complex forms. This rover has something that's never been taken to Mars before, and that's a drill capable of drilling 2 meters into the surface, which then will give us an opportunity to look at the conditions below the surface, which has never been done before.
The quickest we can basically do it with chemical propulsion is 6 to 8 months. NASA is currently working on what's called the SLS, or the Space Launch System, which is going to be a new rocket which will rival the Saturn V, which we used to get to the moon. But even that rocket still is going to be limited by astrodynamics. So there's only some times during their orbits where they actually orbit and they're close together in distance. Other than that, they start getting farther and farther apart. And it's every 22 months that Mars and Earth basically get in this closest point, which is what we want to minimize the amount of fuel and decrease the amount of time it takes to get to Mars. Now, the book did talk about ion propulsion. And that is a technology which may sound futuristic, but actually is used already on hundreds of satellites. It's extremely fuel efficient, but the amount of force is equivalent to like pieces of paper or the weight of paper clips in your hand is really low force. So for that even to be conceivable, like in the book, we'd have to have a fictional nuclear reactor that was way beyond what we currently can do in terms of being lightweight, but providing the immense amount of power required to generate the force for these rockets to get there quickly. For many years now, we've been looking at these ion thrusters, which will be very important for placing cargo on Mars and supporting a manned mission, but they're not powerful enough to be able to rescue a man from Mars.
You know, like any good story, you know, some of the scientific theories that he uses are stretched a bit, but I think it's all grounded in pretty good science.
Like we learned from Apollo 13, we are very resourceful, right, when we are in those stressful situations. We can be creative and come up with nice ways to survive.
You know, I think his chances of survival, you know, are pretty good. So we'll see.
So the Cadre satellite is a precursor satellite to a future mission called Armada. We're going to have a large constellation of satellites that go up to low Earth orbit and study the atmosphere. So before we put the spacecraft on the rocket, there's a lot that goes into testing.